Thank you. I love that the doors are open, that the neighborhood can hear all of the laughter going on in this beautiful building. So we have some new faces. Raise your hand, raise your rose if you're new, just so you... Welcome. Thank you all very much for coming. I really appreciate it. So I want to share with you what we're going to do here before we start. I believe very strongly in the power of helping you to have the tools that you need to live an empowered, exciting, enjoyable, serving life. And I get the honor of being with you on the first Sunday of every month at 10:30. But I want to help you beyond that time. And part of it is this altar. An altar is a sacred space that allows you to forget about the mundane and the bills and the cub food list, and you got to make sure you go pick up that charcoal and you got to fill the tank full of gas and you don't forget about that. Oh, I got to get sunscreen before I leave. All that stuff, we're going to leave that out the door. You can pick up your sunscreen at 11:30. Here's going to be where you have some sacredness. So what I invite you to do is, all of us, this is a community altar. I've got some sacred objects up here. I've got a medicine pouch that's very sacred to me. I've got my hoop, which is sacred, my drum, and my walking stick from Lake Harriet, my beloved Lake Harriet. So if you have a sacred item, community, and you want to empower it on the altar today, please do so. Welcome, come on up as I pull in the directions. Oh my gosh, was it a beautiful day. My best friend in the whole wide world, Jean, is here. Say hi, Jean. Hi, Jean! And we woke up this morning like two kids at Christmas time because she doesn't live close by, so we don't get a lot of time together. I go down there all the time, but she doesn't come up here very often. It's more like a spa down where she lives. Mine's like the real life thing. And we woke up this morning at 6 o'clock and it was nice out. We were like, oh my God, it's nice, it's nice, it's nice, let's get dressed, let's go! We gotta go to Lake Harriet, we gotta go to Lake Harriet, down there. And I'll tell you what, we are grateful for the walk we had around Lake Harriet. Do you all know how many beautiful people run around Lake Harriet on Sunday morning at about 8:45? Like Greek gods and goddesses are glistening, perfect, we're going, ha, ha, ha. We're grateful for this day, we're grateful for this day! It was a good way to start a day. And thank you for carving out time in your day to be here. It's important. It's important for you to find those places of being sacred and being present. So as I was working with what was going to come in today, I thought a lot about story. I am writing a lot of stories lately. I've putting finishing touches on my third book. I'm writing a keynote, which is a whole new set of stories that I'm doing, completely new. And so stories are a lot about what I'm dealing with and working with. And I thought about how we don't change our stories very often. Today we're going to look at what your story is, what your story was, and what your story will be. My story starts in the 70s. And my very first real memory is of not being noticed. I had a story. My story played like this. Tell me what your story sounds like in relation to this. My story was, I was a child that was the third in line and last in line of a failed marriage. And so my mom lovingly called me the miracle baby, which is editing for accident. And so I had that story that I wasn't really wanted. And I had a story that played out that said that I wasn't pretty, that I wasn't worthy of attention by anybody, but especially by the opposite sex. My story was, I was the funny chick who had the great personality that could play quarters like the best of them. And, you know, 6 foot beer bong, that's, you know, that's my style. But I wasn't, my story was that I was never the pretty one, or I was never the one that was going to be asked out. And I was never certainly going to be the one that was, comfortable or confident. because my story was that I was the fat chick. And it was this life that I created, this story that I created, that was that I was always going to not quite get there. I wasn't going to quite get it. I remember boys like they were there yesterday. It probably helped that I did the like Harriet walk. But I remember them like they were yesterday, about how, you know, how handsome they were, how funny they were, how smart they were. Or maybe they weren't any of that. Some of them were just hot. But I wanted to be with them. And they didn't want me. They wanted my perfectly beautiful stick best friend, Angela, with the golden long hair, who looked literally like an angel, just, you know, crapped down the perfect human. It was Angela. And so my story was I never could get it. I never could be comfortable in me. And I perpetuated that through my life. And the only way that the story that I told myself was, I'm worthy when I'm getting an A, when a teacher says good job. I'm worthy when I get the promotion. Or, yay, I'll tell you what, one of my favorite days when I was growing up, when I was, you know, 20-something, was I got Employee of the Month. Yay, you like me, you really like me. That was my story. And all that stuff haunted me. And I kept thinking, well, that's just the way life is. That's just the way life is. But you know what? We can write different stories. We can write whatever story we want to write because we're the writers. We're the writers. When I'm writing my book and I kind of write something and it's kind of, that's not so good. And I know it's not so good. My husband, my lovely beleaguered husband, will help edit me and go, that's not a very good line. Okay, cross it out. Well, you don't know. No, yeah, you're really not. So, okay, and then, you know, something good will come out. A better story will come out. So we can choose. We can choose. What's our new story? So for me, I lived 30-some years, 37 years, having a particular story of this is who you are. This is who you're going to be. And you're not going to experience any other joy outside of what you've already carved out. And I decided I wanted something different than that. And so I just started to craft a different story. And we decide that we want something different. We decide that I wanted to be in a different body. I wanted to be in a body that I could actually move into, in, that I was comfortable in. And I'm getting there. And there's different stories that I've shifted about acceptance and abundance and worthiness of goodness, you know? And so I think, how do we change our story? It's not enough to just go, I'm gonna change my story. Here we go. I mean, because you've all tried that, right? I've tried it. It doesn't work. It doesn't work when you just go, I'm gonna change. Today's the day that I'm gonna metamorphosize. Right? January 1st, the perpetual day of misguided hope. I'm going to lose that weight this year. I'm going to get that job. I'm going to get that relationship. I'm going to get rid of that relationship. Whatever it is, you decide these things, but it doesn't happen in those big momentous moments. It happens in choice. By what presents itself to you.
because you're not alone. We don't create new stories alone. We create them in partnership and collaboration and connection with others, right? No great things ever happen. See?
No great thing has ever happened alone. It takes a village. It takes a team. So we gotta ask. We gotta start asking. So when I started on my journey to be a different, have a different story, I started to say, I really wanna get into a relationship that's not toxic, that's not abusive, that's not, you know, totally bad for me. Completely and utterly wrong. I'd like to start there. And in 1995, there was an incredibly handsome man across the room in a conference room, and I was a project manager, and he was a developer, and he was hot. And he was far hotter than I thought I deserved. He was like Richard, he literally still does look like Richard Gere. And I looked like the Michelin man. But he was so captivating and so funny and so smart. And he saw those things in me too. And so on November 9th, I asked him out on a date to the Christmas party. I thought that was safe. There's a whole story there too. Anyway, I asked him. So when I meet tons of women, because I speak mostly to women's organizations, and they'll go, oh, how did you get a man like that? Oh, he sounds perfect. Believe me, he's not, but he sounds it. And then, how did you get him? I said, I asked him. Trust me, I'd be the most popular stage prep theater techie background in Chicago, Illinois, spinster, drinking at the bar every other night, hoping and praying that I'd get lucky sometime this month if I didn't have the balls to have asked him. He never would have asked me. He just wouldn't have. So I asked, and then I acted. I actually did it. I actually went through all the scary parts that you go through when you're connecting with someone. You go through those places of, oh, I'm not good enough, I'm sure he's gonna break up with me and break my heart, and oh, I can just prove how he's just gonna just tear me to shreds, right? We can all do that. So I asked and I acted. And somehow, boop, I got a little bigger and I got a little more confident and I got a little more like, wow, really? You mean I'm deserving of somebody else giving me love? Whoa, life changer. And then Fear was my big thing. So I asked Spirit, help me figure out what I'm supposed to do to move through this mamby-pamby, I can't do it, thing in my life. So I ask, and then I watch for the signs. And one of the signs was in 2003 that I was starting to get involved in learning about spirituality and, you know, just all this stuff. I didn't know anything about this stuff. None of it. I was like a Easter, Christmas Lutheran. You know, dress up, okay, I don't really get it, but sure, rock on, woo, okay. Well, I wanted to get to know Spirit. So I get involved in, you know, organizations, hear about stuff, and I'm involved in a class that I didn't really pay attention to what I was signing up for. And one of the things was, you know, get involved in a community, we're gonna have a sweat lodge. Excuse me. What's that? Well, it's kind of a big, now bear in mind, I'm one of the freaky, like an aunt walks into the kitchen, I freak, I call Michael, get it out, ah! Not an outdoor person at all. I believe in hotel camping. So it's like a, you know, kind of a, you know, contraption, and it's short, and there's a fire inside. And it's completely dark, and you're going to walk in, and you're going to sit, and you're going to pray, and you're going to sing. And you're going to, for, I don't know, 1, 2, 3 hours. And it's like the hottest thing you'll ever know in your entire life. Like a sweat lodge is a cool, sauna is a cool breeze. A sauna is a cool breeze compared to round 4. when you're like, you turn into the guy from Raiders of the Lost Ark. You know, your face is melting off. You're just freaking out. So I'm sitting there and I'm thinking, okay, wait a minute. You want me to tell me again what I'm going to do? I'm going to get on the ground. Are there mats? Is there a protective device? There isn't. And while I'm waiting, and you know, they're stoking the fire and doing all the things that you do in sacred ceremony, which is that exactly what it is, I saw a snake. A snake. I don't want to do this. But I could feel that inside that was the story, the old story of me. I could feel that inside that thing held more of me. And if I sat out here and went, I get overheated and I really can't. I've got a skin condition. I'm having my period. It's really, my knees are really bad. I can't handle heat. It's not for me. Thanks. No. I could do that, but I wouldn't capture the fear in it, okay? So one of the choices that I made that I got on the ground and went, oh my God, right? And you do the deal. You go through the thing that scares the bejesus out of you. That's how you change your story. You ask for the help, and then when spirit says, oh, by the way, here's one of the ways that you can do it, you act. And usually the acting part isn't super fun. It's not like, here's how I'm going to help you remove layer and layer and layer of fear. Why don't I, you know, take you on a cruise? Maybe that is, actually, the way cruises are going these days. You could actually go into your deepest fears. And then when I thought, you know, I'm feeling like I'm worthy. I'm feeling like I'm changing the story of I'm not worthy of love to I am. And I'm changing the story of I'm a scaredy cat to, no, I'm kind of a badass, actually. I mean, I have my fear. Don't get me wrong. I got a big old list. But I have a smaller list than I did 10 years ago. And the other one was to finally get into my body and finally love it. Or even just like it. Or maybe tolerate it. That's where I wanted to get to, tolerating, paying attention to it, actually acknowledging it. Because I went my whole life avoiding mirrors, cameras, sex with the lights on. Mirrors were just, phoom! You don't look. That was my story. So then I find out about this thing. And I start working with it as a tool. And everybody thinks, oh, it's so hilarious. No, it's not. It's intense. It's an incredibly powerful transformational tool, people. And I found myself in it. So I asked for the help. I said, how do I finally get out of this perpetual state of discontent of myself and my body and my sexuality and my presence and my confidence, and it's all more than just that. You know what I mean, right? It's not about, oh my God, and I got a great body now. Oh, that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about being present, walking around fully. That helped me. I asked for it, and then I had to act, which was terrifying when I was a cheeseburger away from 200 pounds in a hula hoop. Right? You're like, I don't want to do this. People will laugh, people will mock, blah, 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 blah. But I did it anyway. Okay, so these are just three small examples of you can change your story anytime you want. You act after you have asked what you want. And be willing to do it. Now, how do you have the strength to do that? Because I bet you all know now, right, if you even start thinking about your story, how you want to change your story. You've been presented with opportunities to change it. And you let it fly by. Do y'all feel that? Y'all know which one you did that you kind of, oh, yeah, it really was kind of towards what I wanted, but wasn't the right time. Or it wasn't the right, we always have excuses and reasons why it's not. But we look at it and we say, how do we have the strength to do this when we know we can't do it on our own? We do it with spirit. We change our story when we connect with spirit. When we're little kids, born into this world, we understood one thing, that we were divine. We knew that. Because we just came from it. And we're of it. We knew it. We knew it without a shadow of a doubt. And then we start interacting with the world. So we lived vertically. Vertically. Spirit, us, earth. Spirit, us, earth. Huge power source. Then we get born and we go, who's this lovely lady who's giving me hugs and kisses and she's got these amazing milk dispensary systems? Ah! Right? That's what we did when we were kids. We went, we see that. We want that. We want to go for the things that we love and we want to get away from the things that we hate. We start plugging in horizontally. We start plugging into our moms and our dads and our brothers and our sisters and our rooms and our neighborhoods and our friends and our churches and our schools. We start plugging in horizontally to people. We forget. We forget where we came from when our world starts to get more complicated. And what we do, we see what we want. We see what we want. We start speaking what we want. The kids, babies learn, wait a minute, when I go, she brings the milk dispensary system to me. Kids learn that quickly. So they start going, oh, okay, hey, what else could I do? When I make this noise, this happens. They see what they want, they speak what they want, they feel it. The reason why they go to the milk dispensary system is because they want to be able to be held and hugged and nurtured and fed, and that makes them feel good. That makes them feel good in their hearts. And then that's the things that will make them do things. That will make them crawl over to the mom. That'll be the things that they'll do things. They'll move out of their comfort zone. Kids will do that. Have you ever noticed that? When a little kid wants something, it's like survivor. They'll just, okay, I get over here, and then I could get over here, and then I could stand on this, right? They know they do to get what they want. They do to get what they want. And then eventually they have what they want. That's what they are when the kids. When we're adults, the same thing. We see all these things we want. We see the world we want. We speak what we want to do to get it that way. We feel how much joy it will bring us, and we do the activities that we need to do this. If you want to change your story beyond just in your head, but you want to change your story in your life, you are going to have to move more than you're moving now. You are going to have to stop being plugged into an alternative reality that is not yours and start engaging in the reality that is yours. You will have to do. You'll also have to really want it. You gotta really want it. This is where I always messed up in my story, FYI. I could see myself thin. In fact, I saw myself in a midriff shirt. Was always, Janet Jackson was my shero. I wanted to look like Janet Jackson. I could see myself being super hot. And then I could even speak it. I'm going to be doing this. I'm going to go on Weight Watchers for the 70th time. And I could feel that I really, really wanted it. I felt, oh, do I want that so bad? And I'd do it too. I'd measure those exchanges and points. I've done all that, right? We all know how to do stuff like that. But this is what it always stopped me, is the want. Did I really want to be in a smaller body? Did I really want to be in a thinner body, in a body that moved better, that had a little more zazz to it? I didn't, because I had a bunch of stuff I had to heal. 1 out of 4 women admit to having something forced upon them in a sexual way. Admit. When those kinds of things happen, and we all have stuff, we all have stuff. We've all had stuff happen. When those kinds of things happen, they cause wounds, and we need to work through our wounds. And sometimes we stop telling our story, a new story, because we haven't yet gotten through the wound. But that's part of it. It's just part of asking for the help. I want to work through this wound. I want to work through this thing. And then when Spirit provides it, in even the craziest of packages, you act. You act. It's so often we don't even get there. We don't even get there. And the benefit of getting to, I see my new reality, I speak my new reality, I feel like I want to have this new reality, I'm going to do those things necessary to get my new reality, and I really want to experience this newness, the benefit of it on the other side is you don't have to do any of it. Then you just are. You just are. don't you guys feel, I don't know about you, but here's what I feel. I feel so tired of chasing things in the past and the future. I'm tired of it. Are you guys tired of it? Don't you spend far more time than you should regretting the past, worrying about the future? Regretting, worrying. We waste it. We waste this whole precious thing, regretting and worrying. So how do we go and do all these amazing things? We step into I am. We remember what we remembered when we came in the first time. And that is, you are a vertical oriented person who has been horizontally attuned. Help me, follow me on this. If you really can spend the majority of your time vertically oriented to that which is your sacred source, you, and you here present on the earth, boom, then you have so much more juice to change your story. You'll have the courage to get in the sweat lodge. You'll have the courage to step in the hula hoop. You'll have the courage to ask him out on a date. You'll have the courage to do the job interview. You'll have the courage to reach out to that one person you haven't reached out to in 10 years. You'll have the courage when you get vertically aligned with I am. You don't have to change. There's nothing to change. You just got to remember. You just got to remember what you forgot. And when we're in I am, and we're vertically connected into this world, to our power sources, we're vertically connected to source, we're vertically connected to the earth, then when we're fully more present, then when we reach new people in our lives, we're not coming from that horizontal, will you fix me? Will you make me feel better? Will you feed me? Will you nurture me? Will you pay me money? Will you give me all the things that I need? Will you please? Will you? And you start plugging in horizontally to everybody. You see the difference in that? Energetically, when you think about how many people do you plug into for your source of power? I have plugged into a family member my whole life, and I never even see him ever, but he still, I can feel a cord. I can still feel a cord right now. And that, so we're not going from let's don't do this and let's do all this. It's a dance. It's a dance on how many times we're plugged into other people externally. Because here's the problem with plugging into people externally or plugging into scenarios. Anybody ever been plugged into a scenario that says, I just know this is going to happen. It has to happen. We have to sell our house in 90 days. Ha ha, tee hee, ooh, that's hilarious. You're going to tell God he has to do it? Good luck with that. You ever been burned with that? I have. It has to. It just has to. No, it doesn't. When we plug in externally to those things horizontally, people, places, things, jobs, all that, they can go away, right? They can leave. People die. They close businesses. They shut down. They move. They move. So that's the only way that you can live in a true place of peace, because that's ultimately what we all want. We just want a place of peace. If we can go, let's reorient ourselves to I am. So let's do that today. Let's do a journey together. Get comfortable. Get your feet on the ground. Cleansing breaths with me to arrive fully and complete me completely. Just slow everything down. Just relax. Spirit comes in the still point, in the stillness, in between the inhale and the exhale. Breathe in, and I want you to imagine now, we're going to take a journey. I want you to see in your mind your new story. What is your new story of who you are and how you walk in this world? You are a man that does what? You are a woman that does what? That lives in what way? What is the story that you want to live? See it fully, like it's Technicolor, like it's in your, in, as playing as a movie. And don't worry about rewriting. Don't worry about it not being believable. And don't worry about how you're going to do it. You don't have to worry about how you're going to do it. See the new story. And then imagine, as you travel down into your throat, imagine that you are going to speak these truths. You're speaking the new story to the people in your lives. You're speaking, here's what you want. Here's how I can help you. You're speaking your new story. Who do you need to share this with? And who do you need to not worry about what they say in return? You see that new story, you share that new story. Then you drop into your heart and you feel what that's going to feel like when you have that new story. You don't have that burden anymore. You don't have that albatross, that smallness, that limitation. What is that going to feel like? What is that going to feel like in your body? Bless you. How are you going to wake up in the morning knowing that this is your new story? How's it going to feel to connect to more people, new people? Having new doors open, having new energy of all kinds coming your way, new green energy, new healing energy, new creative energy. Feel that. Drop into your belly and sink into, what is it that you need to do to change your story? What are the specific actions you need to take to change your story? Knowing that it's not a quick fix. Drop down even further now into the base of your pelvis and think about, do you really, really want this change in your story? What part of you doesn't want it? This is where your shadow is living. That's saying, no, 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 no. Why, like it just fine the way it is. What part do you need to work through to move that don't want out? And then let it just plunk right on into your energy, right on into every cell and all of the spaces between the cells of this new reality. You can just decide now, I have now a new story. Up until now, I didn't have what it took. And now I do. Up until now, I didn't know how to move forward, and now I do. Up until now, I didn't know that I had the resources at my disposal to help me create this new story. But now I do. Up until now, I thought I had to do it all alone. Breathe in and know that you are seeing this new story unfold. You are speaking it to who you need to speak it to. You are feeling the joy that is coming from it, the release that's coming from it, the relief, the healing that's coming from it. Know that you're going to do those things that you need to do in inspired action after you have asked the question, and know that you truly want it. And with all of that plugged into horizontal, plugged into other people and other circumstances and other scenarios, just know that that prayer's in play. That's happening now. You've already done it. Now is the time when we remember, wait a minute, we've had this all along. Because I am. Not I will be, or I do, or I have done. I am. I am spirit. Breathe in and let this new awareness of your own divinity come on into your heart and into your body and into your soul and into your space of I am. That prayer is in motion. You can trust it. Breathe in and just be relaxed, knowing that everything is happening exactly as it should. All of the wheels are in motion because you have asked and you will act in the presence of I am. Breathe in and feel one last moment of gratitude for the sacred moment you've had, and come back into the room, opening your eyes and seeing things clearly. Now is the time when we're going to do an offering, and I would like to share with you some notions of that. This community, do you get fed by this community? You guys feel like you're supported? Well, the reason why it's in existence is because people support it. And I want to share with you, as the spiritual director, we need your support. We need it. We don't want it, we need it to keep going. So if you can give, give. If you can give a lot, give a lot! Because we want to keep serving. And how I want to offer my moment right now, as we bless the money that you're going to give and know that it's going to come back to you, know that you're supporting something bigger and something beautiful and your own growth, is that I'd like to offer up a little hoop dance as my offer of joy to you. Play some whatever I'm hoping to. Stevie Wonder.
There are people who have let the problems of today lead them to conclude that for them life is not the way. But every problem has an answer, and if yours you cannot find, you should talk it over to him. He'll give you peace of mind. When you feel your life's too hard, just go have a talk with God. Many of us feel we walk alone without a friend, communicating with one who lives with within, forgetting all about the one who never ever let you down. And you can talk to him anytime, he's always around. When you feel your life's too hard, just go have a talk with God. That's known throughout the world for solving the problems of all men, women, little boys and girls. When you feel your life's too hard,